Aaron Copland's Fanfare for the Common Man has been widely affiliated with American patriotism almost since its composition. Its distinctive sound, a slow tempo, brass solo with percussion interjections, sustained, angular, disjunct melody, and diatonic language with stress on triadic harmony, is now a musical token for Americanness. There is an irony in the linking of the fanfare with American nationalism. Copland himself seems not to have intended it. Eugene Goossens commissioned the piece for the 1942 season of the Cincinnati Symphony and suggested to Copland a fanfare as a tribute for soldiers or for airmen or sailors. But Copland's notes show that he agonized over the title and that he apparently considered fanfare for the four freedoms, for the day of victory, for future heroes, for the post-war world, for a solemn ceremony in which man's spirit is rededicated to the proposition of a better world, among still others. In none of these titles is America or the Allied forces directly named, and the ultimate title, For the Common Man, is designed, by the composer's own explanation, to transcend national interests. Whether Copland intended to draw a sharp line between humanism and patriotism, in wartime America, such distinction proved too subtle to survive. The fanfare's musical landscape, which I call the triumphant exordium, is one of a handful of Copland sounds that have become intertwined with American identity. Many of these sounds are closely bound up with Americana because the extra musical subjects with which they were first associated were unequivocally American. The Virgin Frontier, the Wild West, New York City, rural New England, Abraham Lincoln, John Henry. As these Copland sounds have been appropriated since their emergence in the 1940s, by the composer himself and by others, that association with Americanness has become more complicated. John Williams' orchestral fanfare, Summon the Heroes, was written for the 1996 Summer Olympics in Atlanta. Listen and decide whether this musical approach sounds familiar. The appropriation of Copland's sound is obvious here. Summon the Heroes would also seem to reflect the original implication of Copland's title Fanfare for the Common Man through association with an international sporting spectacle whose ideals trump any one nation's political supremacy. On the other hand, the 1996 Olympiad was hosted in the U.S., and John Williams, one of the most famous living American composers, was commissioned to compose its anthem. The specific context for this music, like that of wartime America in 1942, thus smudges the distinction between transnational humanism and American nationalism. Does Summon the Heroes fate the international spirit of the Olympics, the hosting of this Olympic event on American soil, or both? The triumphant exordium leaves room for all these perspectives. If it is so easy to make this connotative leap from humanism to American nationalism, it is, to crudely paraphrase Neil Armstrong, one small step from there to celebrating the United States lunar missions. James Horner's main title music for the Ron Howard film Apollo 13 takes that step. Horner's appropriation sets the stage, as all fanfares do, but this is a specifically American fanfare that celebrates a national purpose, supremacy in outer space, and in lunar exploration. The opening of Apollo 13 complicates the triumphant exordium by troping it, or combining it, with another Copland sound, protagonistic introspection. Briefly, protagonistic introspection is a ruminating Copland sound emphasized in works like Quiet City and Appalachian Spring. This sequence, narrated by Walter Cronkite, summarizes the early Apollo missions and eulogizes the astronauts killed in the launch pad disaster of Apollo 1. Horner captures the astronauts' heroic sacrifice on behalf of the United States with a musical landscape that combines the triumphant exordium with protagonistic introspection. You'll hear trumpet and percussion motives from the opening fanfare set against a hymn-like prayer in the strings. By pitting the exordium topic against the contemplative prayer, Horner casts the nation as the introspective protagonist in this trope.
Right. We have the crew crossing gantry for capsule ingress.
Roger that.
Inspired by the late President Kennedy, in only 7 years, America has risen to the challenge of what he called the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. After trailing the Russians for years with our manned space program, and after that sudden and horrible fire on the launch pad during a routine test that killed American astronauts Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chapman, there were serious doubts that we could beat the Russians to the moon.
Williams and Horner's work is virtually contemporaneous. Horner is so certain of the triumphant exordium sound as a recognizable symbol of American exceptionalism that he is willing to trope it against another topic almost immediately. In contrast, Williams has, perhaps ambiguously, returned the triumphant exordium to its origins in celebration of a transnational sporting event. Both musical contexts complicate the exordium's connection with American nationalism. Apollo 13 by pitting it against another Copland sound, Summon the Heroes by its glorification of transnational human achievement. A final example by Copland himself pushes the limits of the triumphant exordium's connections with Americanness and with triumph itself to the breaking point. Dance Panels began as a ballet without plot, commissioned by the dancer Jerome Robbins. Unlike the other music we've just surveyed, it has no overt extra-musical associations aside from being composed for dance. If I warn you that you'll hear a solo trumpet sing out a slow, angular, diatonic melody that depends on a repeating note rhythmic motive, it might catalyze you to expect the triumphant exordium. And in a certain sense, that's correct. But that fanfare is tempered here, softened with warm, glowing harmonies in the strings and woodwinds. The percussion hammer strokes of this style are tamed to become barely audible double bass pizzicati. These orchestration choices point to protagonistic introspection.
Thank you.
The juxtaposition of these two topics opens up a new expressive space. This music is neither simply heroic nor simply plaintive. Nor is it specifically American. We've already seen that Americanness isn't a necessary feature of these sounds, even if Copland and others associate them, sometimes ambiguously, with quintessentially American settings. Perhaps Dance Panels is suggesting a nostalgic or wistful desire for heroism, or memory of triumphs now beyond reach. This perspective is reinforced by the work's conclusion, where this passage is restated and then motifically disassembled and musically unraveled, its remaining triumph dissolving away into an atmosphere of distant melancholy. The repetition of this music, here and elsewhere, lends the entire work a sense of longing, as if the epic story behind it, whatever that may be, is still remembered, but beyond the telling.